Attend to the pleas of your people with heavenly care. O Lord, we pray that they may see what must be done and gain strength to do what they have seen. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Samuel. Hannah rose after a meal at Shiloh and presented herself before the Lord. At the time, Eli, the priest, was sitting on a chair near the doorpost of the Lord's temple. In her bitterness, she prayed to the Lord, weeping copiously, and she made a vow, promising, O Lord of hosts, if you look with pity on the misery of your handmaid, if you remember me and do not forget me, if you give your handmaid a male child, I will give him to the Lord for as long as he lives. Neither wine nor liquor shall he drink, and no razor shall ever touch his head. As she remained long in prayer before the Lord, Eli watched her mouth, for Hannah was praying silently, though her lips were moving, her voice could not be heard. Eli, thinking her drunk, said to her, How long will you make a drunken show of yourself, sober up from your wine? It isn't that, my Lord, Hannah answered. I am an unhappy woman. I have had neither wine nor liquor. I was only pouring out my troubles to the Lord. Do not think your handmaid an e'er-do-well. My prayer has been prompted by my deep sorrow and misery. Eli said, Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him. She replied, Think kindly on your maidservant, and left. She went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and no longer appeared downcast. Early the next morning, they worshipped before the Lord, and then returned to their home in Ramah. When Elkanah had relations with his wife Hannah, the Lord remembered her. She conceived, and at the end of her term, bore a son, whom she called Samuel, since she had asked the Lord for him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My heart exults in the Lord, my Savior.
My heart exults in the Lord, my Savior.
My heart exalts in the Lord. My horn is exalted in my God. I have swallowed up my enemies. I rejoice in my victory.
My heart exalts in the Lord, my Savior.
The bowels of the mighty are broken, while the tottering gird on strength. The well-fed hire themselves out for bread, while the hungry batten and spoil. The barren wife bears seven sons, while the mother of many languishes.
My heart exalts in the Lord, my Savior.
The Lord puts to death and gives life. He casts down to the netherworld. He raises up again. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He humbles. He also exalts.
My heart exalts in the Lord, my Savior.
He raises the needy from the dust. From the dung heap he lifts up the poor, to seat them with nobles and make a glorious throne their heritage.
My heart exalts in the Lord, my Savior. Alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus came to Capernaum with his followers, and on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and taught. The people were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. In their synagogue was a man with an unclean spirit. He cried out, What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Jesus rebuked him and said, Quiet, come out of him. The unclean spirit convulsed with him, and with a loud cry came out of him. All were amazed and asked one another, What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. His fame spread everywhere throughout the whole region of Galilee. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I've been teaching with authority. What does this mean? What is it about Jesus, his words, and his actions that cause many people to say, a new teaching with authority? What does he do? How does Jesus speak? Here, the scriptures tell us clearly, with authority means that Jesus is convinced. He understands fully. He understands very well. He understands his mission and his purpose in life, and how he has come from the Father, he himself being the incarnate Word, he himself being the second person of the Trinity, God in the flesh. My brothers and sisters, we just celebrated the baptism of the Lord, didn't we? And how beautiful that feast is. And that feast is not only about Jesus, it's about us. And about how you and I are crafted in such a way to the image of God, where his hands and his feet and his voice today, you and I are his sons and daughters, brothers of the Lord. And how beautiful that gift is in Holy Baptism. How unique it is that we become children of God through those life-saving waters. We've been reborn again. Outside of baptism, there is darkness. Outside of baptism, we're not grafted with God in a particular unique way. But on that day of baptism, something happens. The soul has encountered itself with God, and we become sons and daughters of God and brothers and sisters of the Lord. Something that has not entered into our very being until that day of baptism. It is very important. It's not just a ritual, is it? It's just not a Catholic ceremony, is it? What is so unique about baptism that it changes our entire relationship with Jesus, our entire relationship with God? Well, you and I understand that completely. We are his children. We are one with him. We're uniquely one with him. And so when he teaches with authority, he teaches that because he's convinced. You and I must be convinced that you and I are children of God and heirs to the kingdom. Heirs to the kingdom. That kingdom of God is settling right within us. And everything that we do and everything that we say must be based upon what we are convinced, what we have come to know and to appreciate. Even when it comes to battling with the evil one, here once again, the evil one or the unclean spirit cries out and says, what do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come here to destroy us? Do you notice that Jesus does not answer his question? None of us are to respond to evil. None of us are to converse with evil, as if we are now answering the evil one's questions. What does Jesus do? He commands the evil one to be quiet and to come out of the person. There is no dialogue here. Exorcists will tell people who believe they are possessed by a demonic spirit never to converse with the spirit that is evil. Never. Never to dialogue with evil. But to command It's beautiful and awe-inspiring that God gives us authority over unclean spirits. We have them all around us, don't we? Pride, covetousness, lust, anger, gluttony, envy, sloth. All of these unclean spirits that really enter into our hearts and minds at times and wants us to really follow the unclean spirit instead of God. And sometimes we have to be very clear that we are not, even though it sounds convincing, we are convinced by what God has done. You remember the Garden of Eden, how our first parents, when they heard about this and when the evil one was tantalizing them, it sounded convincing. It sounded convincing. That's why they followed. That's why they listened. And they dialogued. They dialogued. Remember Eve? She was dialoguing with the serpent. Never to do that. Never. Be quiet. Get out of here. You have no place here. Go to the fires of hell where you belong. That's the only thing that should utter from our lips. Because then it will show us that we are convinced that we have the power from God to even have dominion over unclean spirits that want to take away our baptismal innocence of who we are, created in the image and likeness of God, and we are His presence in our words, our actions, our hands, our voice, our eyes. Let us be more like Christ, whom we have been baptized and crafted to in this beautiful sacrament of holy baptism. After reflecting on God's holy word, let us now place these petitions before the Lord with confidence and trust.
For church leaders, to be conformed ever more fully to Christ through their ministry, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who exercise authority in government, may God soften their hearts to the plight of those most in need. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who live with the burden of discrimination, may God strengthen them and grant them His comfort. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us gathered here, may the calling of Christ echo in our hearts, giving clarity to our desires and actions. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, may they be welcomed into the eternal light of Christ in heaven. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick and suffering, John Tate, Robert Tobias, Martha Watson, and all those on our prayers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Joseph H. Bloom III, for whom this Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. We also pray for the spiritual and temporal needs of St. Mary's Parish, so that all of us may further the mission of Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, especially for members of our own parish family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we place these petitions before you, if they are accord with your holy will. We ask you to grant them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the bread we offer you, fruit of the earth and the work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed
are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you, fruit of the vine and the work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Praise to Jesus and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. That it may restore them to holiness and obtain what they devoutly entreat. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In Him you have been pleased to renew all things, giving us all a share of his fullness. For though he was in the form of God, he emptied himself, and by the blood of his cross brought peace to all creation. Therefore he has been exalted above all things, and to all who obey him has become the source of eternal salvation. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim,
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the Father of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord, Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. Once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have called us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered to one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, and with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and with all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, men informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sinning, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant you peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
With you, O Lord, is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light.
The body of Christ.